Sorry about that.
Originally, tonight's meeting was going to be Sarah talking about curriculum. However, this is the first time in several years that we've used this workshop for the budget, so that's what we need to focus on. So 2 weeks ago, I think most of us were at the budget presentation with the town council. So everyone is well aware that we have $260-some thousand to cut out of our budget. So I think we will turn it over to Tom. He will go through all of the cuts that the administrators have made, and we'll let him get through his whole presentation, and then we will start the discussion.
The district leadership team met right before the vacation to look at the $266,000 that we needed to come up with. Which is kind of odd in that we have an 8.1% increase in the budget, of which take away the building project, the 5.4% increase that we're being held to, and it's probably the most difficult budget year I know in the last 5 years that I can remember. And the first time we actually had to go into existing programs and make decisions about cutting staff, personnel, existing programs that we have now. So we have come up with some suggested cuts that we would like to discuss with you. We know there may be some that are a bit controversial, and there may be better ways to do this, and that's why we're here tonight, to talk with you about maybe your ideas, that maybe there are things that you can think of that we didn't. I'd also like to preface this all by, when we went through this process as a district leadership team, before we even began, we made a decision as a team that there was one issue we wanted to stay away from as much as possible, and it was the one issue that was extremely important to the entire team, and that was to not increase class size if we could help it. It was probably the one sacred cow that we had that we felt was extremely important. You could argue that in some cases, because of some programs that we cut, staffing decreases, obviously it is, especially in high school, going to have an effect on class size. But that was something that we really wanted on this to stay away from. So I'll pass these around. And while you're getting a hold of those, I also would like to let you know that the district leadership team also met with the executive committee of the Cape Elizabeth Education Foundation, not about the budget, but just to talk about some of the needs the district has. This foundation, as you probably are aware, will be embarking on a capital campaign in the fall. We wanted to have kind of a workshop setting with the district leadership team to talk about what kinds of things might the foundation be able to support the school district on, not just an individual classroom, mini grants, but more of a larger scale kind of issues that still meet the mission of the foundation as far as offering things that are innovative and creative and help us to achieve our mission and the mission of the foundation. After that meeting, and I think prompted by the kinds of ideas they heard from the district leadership team, they came back and I was called, and the request was made that because of the emphasis the district leadership team put on technology and the laptop initiative, several members of the executive committee felt that this is an opportunity that we have as a school district to really promote that kind of learning in our schools. This is important that it was grant, which I did. I met with, we had a special meeting of the executive committee, and the Kentwood for Education Foundation unanimously supported a $27,000 contribution toward the laptop initiative at the high school. So that'll get us a long way, you know, probably get us out of that little predicament we had with, as far as the parent contribution. So it was really great to see that kind of support for technology. And not to belabor it, but I think it's important to note that the foundation's purpose is not to supplant the regular operating budget. This is something that's a bit unique, and the argument that I offered is that if the governor had never proposed the one-to-one computing program in the schools 2 years ago that began, we would never have put in our budget. We would continue on our way of trying to increase access, which has always been a goal. But now, faced with the idea that this may go away, something that is innovative, and this does put Maine in a different place from other school districts, other states, and puts us in a much different place. We'd really like to keep that going, and the foundation really wants to support that, but not under the pretense of taking care of things that the school board and the community should be putting in the budget. There was concern on part of some individuals that, you know, that some of the remarks made at the workshop with the town council, that donations be made to the Education Foundation, which is a wonderful thing, but not care of the budget that the town should support. So they want to be very careful about that. So anyway, the motion was to contribute $27,000 contingent on the remainder of the money in the first year of the lease either being supported by the budget of the school board or from other sources. So they left that flexibility. If you came up with a different way to do it, that's fine, but someone has to raise the rest of that money. My suggestion would be that you keep that money in the budget, because it would be that much more difficult next year if you don't have something in the budget to raise the rest of that money. This for you at least is going to be entering in. So, that being said, as we get into these cuts, you'll notice the laptops are not on there. It is something that at least the district leadership team is hoping that we can continue at least the first year of the lease and continue that first year lease. The way these cuts are broken down, they're broken down by area, either in the schools, the things that are district-wide, and when we get into athletics, we'll talk to you about why that's a separate issue. Across the board, and the first item is part of is field trips. This year, we made an attempt to, 2 years ago, we cut off field trip dollars. We tried to put some of that back in the budget. So you'll notice in all of the schools, the money that we put in for field trips has been cut out. So there'll be no money for field trips, and we've been doing that for a few years now at the schools, that it's pay as you go for field trips. We made an additional cut in furniture, and you'll notice that again in all three schools. Our plan always has been to replace three rooms of furniture. I don't know if we've ever been able to do that. And the last couple of years, we've maybe been able to have one or two rooms in different schools, but we've never been able to replace furniture at the rate we would have liked. And this goes way back to the building project, K-8. The furniture was not part of the project. So at that time, the charge was, well, the schools can take care of that furniture over time. I know in the last 5 years, we haven't been able to maintain the plan. So the furniture that's left that plan 11 years old is still not happening. But it's a big ticket item that can save us some money. I will say that the needs of the high school in terms of furnishing the rooms, because we will have the portable classrooms, we're taking care of all those needs. We're doing some sharing. The middle school has been, we're hoping, is able to come up with some furniture to give to the high school. So we're really looking everywhere to find furniture to make sure we have enough furniture in all of our classrooms, because we will be using, for the first time in several years, all 28 classrooms at Pine Cove. So that was an issue. The high school obviously is using more classrooms, so we just need more furniture. So we're taking care of equipping all of the rooms, and the furniture that we are using, although some of it is needs to be replaced, it's not a safety issue, so I'm concerned with that. And then the last item at Pine Cove, which also you'll see in all areas, is professional development learning results. As you know, we're embarking on and are well into local assessment systems, and a lot of the work that's required for professional development mandated by the learning results for the last, I think since the account was created several years ago, each school, it's been $8,000. This year there was an attempt to increase that in each of the schools by $1,000, and we're going to go back to what we had. So we'll have again $8,000, which that amount, I don't think our professional development accounts has increased in the last 3 years anyway. But that learning results money has not increased, I think, since it was first put into the budget, so before my time. As we go into the middle school, the items that we haven't already discussed, one is in equipment, and that's a major line item there, with band and physical education equipment. We're very fortunate in that the middle school and the high school work very closely. The two directors are in constant communication, and our hope is that through being able to purchase some band equipment, whether it's at the high school or at the middle school, we'll be able to get something. There's somewhere that's still left in that. I think we left it in the high school account, but because they work together closely, they're going to make some decisions about this one instrument for the middle school and the high school, and it's still for the music program. So it's nice to see that they're working together, looking at the needs for both bands and trying to come up with what piece of equipment is the best, is the duct tape wearing out the most, so that we can get those drums or whatever it might be. And it is, and some of the equipment, it is to that point, and some of the stuff is being held together. The other part of the inspiration software has been eliminated with the last first round of cuts. We cut the one half and tried to save half, but this is the other half of that software. It's at the middle school. At the high school, we are recommending a cut in an existing program. And for those of you that were on the board, we put Latin in as a program 2 years ago. There is going to be, the entire program is going to be eliminated in the position that goes with that, and that is an existing program, so we won't have WAC next year at the high school. There were a smaller number of students moving on to Latin 2, but a large number for Latin 1. So I guess if you're going to do it any year, this wasn't as bad, because I think in prior years we had many more students moving on to Latin 2, so that they would, we'd be hard-pressed to offer Latin 2 anyway next year, but we had 38 students at the center for Latin 1, so we won't offer Latin next year. We've decreased again by 0.6 the number of teachers needed at the high school. And Jeff, and after I get through, we'll go back and ask questions of Jeff where exactly they're coming from. But you have to remember that at the high school, with the increase of 50 students, we might need a some sections, so many sections of math, so many sections of social studies. So as they look at the numbers, they make their best guess at where those bodies need to fall. But again, this was a further reduction of the original four teachers by another 0.6, and we're at now for new teaching positions, Jeff, in high school,
2.1.
2.1 now for new, so it's going to cut just about half of the original request. Furniture and field trip at the high school, same as the other schools, and professional development. A number of cuts in co-curricular positions. These are existing positions. And the programs, we will still have these programs, speech, debate, theater, those programs will still exist. But what we've cut down is the number of positions that we have that support some of those programs. In the theater program, there's a technical director, there's theater assistant positions. If those may, we've thought about, they, and the same thing with jazz band, they have a lot of technical people that support the jazz band in stipend positions. The jazz band will continue, all those other programs will continue. If they desire to have some of those support positions, maybe up to the parent groups to make money, in a similar manner that we do for athletics, for some extra coaches in those kinds of positions to do that. But they've been taken out of this budget. At the district-wide level, we had quite a discussion about this was a very difficult position to change, the technology technician. We originally had in the budget a position that was at a much higher level, someone with some expertise to come in to assist us in the technology area. We feel that with some of the needs that Gary has in technology, that we might be able to at least get some of the needs addressed through in that tech type level position in technology, rather than a very expensive $50,000 position. We obviously won't be able to advertise in the same way, won't be able to get someone with maybe some of the expertise we need, especially if we move ahead with the laptops. And we've had that long discussion about all the new equipment at the middle school and how pressed the technology department is. This does give them some extra help, but not at the same level of expertise. Now, in the past, we have hired people at that level, and they've gained a lot of expertise. And remember, in other budgets, we had to up their salary because they'd be losing them. We didn't pay them more. We obviously do much better than that tech salary with the expertise that we have. But our hope is to maintain give some assistance to the technology area and make them that tech position rather than a full-fledged technology type person. The next item is one I know that will be some discussion about, but we did cut a bus, which is a big item. It's the largest item on the list at $62,000, and that purchase a bus. You all are very aware. We've done this before. And we're very aware of the situation where this revenue back to the purchase of the bus, but it's an easy cut to make on the expense side that we have to pay for it later. It's easier to put on the list. Special education social worker, we moved 0.5 of that into local entitlement and pay for part of that through local entitlement funds, which were moved. Allowed to do. Local entitlement is one area through federal government that actually is probably the only area that funding has gone up. So we're hoping to be able to move some funds in there. Now, as you look at local entitlement, there are certain things that you can and can't do with that. You can't supplant, I think, existing positions, but since it's a new position, you can do some things to move some of that money. Some minimal cuts in technology staff development and technology supplies, and then a further decrease in our CIP budget. The last one is in athletics. where the recommendation is through a combination of maybe some, if we can find some further reductions in athletics, but the majority of that through instituting a participation fee for athletics. That would give us that number, which also is a very big number. That gives us the $266,547 that brings us to 8.1%. Questions?
Who wants to start?
Special ed social worker moved to local entitlement. I presume we were going to receive X dollars of local entitlement money, and that was calculated into the budget. Question mark.
Yeah, well, local entitlement's not, it's not part of the budget. Well,
it's a special fund.
It's a special fund.
I understand that, but we, let me rephrase. We were anticipating the receipt of local entitlement funds. We were going to spend the local entitlement funds. Now we're putting this in. So what are we not spending local entitlement funds on?
Last year, we had a $50,000 carryover. And when I called the State Department, and it looks like we're going to have a $50,000 increase. I don't think our carryover for next year will be as much, but I feel comfortable that we can do this at this point without jeopardizing our whole program.
So am I hearing that we're not going to do without something else in order to shift this into local entitlement?
Yeah. Yeah. We need the social worker, right? I need to figure out a way. We need that half-time social worker to meet our mandate.
I understand that. The question is, you know, I'm making the assumption that we have X amount of dollars.
Anticipated dollars, right?
Right.
Right. And if we had already planned before the town council action to spend that local entitlement money, that's what I'm saying. To me, logic says something else had to disappear.
What I was able to do is, when I looked at what we had left this year, we ordered all of our supplies for next year. The majority of our supplies for next year had been ordered on this year's local entitlement. Trying to free up some money to help fund this position. I still will have some money in the supply room.
You buy all special ed supplies for what? So that by buying the same stuff, of course, same stuff this year, we don't have to buy special supplies.
And you're saying you won't have any money to carry over to next year?
We will, but I'm trying to make sure that the carryover will be a little bit less than last year. It's hard to predict at this point, but it looks like probably 30,000. I feel comfortable that we can do that and it will not jeopardize the program.
I have a question about furniture. Is this, in Pine Cove, is that taking out every room, or are we leaving something?
We leave one in the new classroom.
One. Okay, and what about in the middle school?
We leave one.
And what about in the high school?
We ordered more in the high school because we had to put the portables.
The portables in the kindergarten room, so that's what was a little more.
Yeah, this particular, wasn't this particular cut, was the library too?
That's the library too.
So we're still getting six rooms of furniture at the high school? How many rooms?
Four.
Four, so then we're, the other two rooms.
We are recycling. Yeah,
what we have left.
We're recycling what we have between us and the principal. So, because we need that for the portables and the kindergarten classrooms, once those are transferred, so you're looking at seven classrooms.
So nothing's being replaced, everything is just being equipped.
Correct.
I had a question on the curriculum items at high school.
budget, do those represent cuts from what's previously funded at this school year? I mean, were there any increases in any of those areas in this, in our last budget?
Existing, they've been in existence for, I don't know, how many years?
So what percentage of those programs does that cut represent? For instance, what do we fund this curricular speech and debate program? What does 1725 represent in terms of a percentage of our program?
In terms of the stipends, my guess is it's about 30-40%. In terms of the overall funding of it, I would guess it's about 20%, something like that.
Well, no, I'm just wondering, like.
It's in the neighborhood, sort of.
And is that about the same amount then for the debate and then the technical, that's part of the theater?
That is a person.
Is that a theater thing?
Yes, the technical director, yes, the both, that one and the theater system are.
And so what amount then, so that's, I mean, that's over 3,000 from theater. What percentage is out of the theater curricular budget?
Again, I have to separate between stipends and other things. In terms of stipends, that's probably, I'm guessing, about 20% of what's done. The overall program is somewhere between 10 and 20, but you might guess that.
And so we've been able to maintain funding for all of those areas at those levels for several years?
Yes. There haven't been any changes in the stipends or additions to the stipends. You know, what any proposed for this coming school.
But from what? I don't need specific figures. I'm just trying to get a feeling for, you know, to what extent those programs, I mean, I know you said, Tom, that they'll continue to exist. But what does it mean in terms of,
well,
know, less
to be honest with you, I have started to have some conversations with Mr. Mullen about the theater program. I know his preference would be, instead of doing this amount of production this way, to do it slightly differently. I don't know if he can do that, get that same number. But we can talk about that, which could mean an elimination of one of the programs. For the others, I mean, his concern is that for the others, those are both people who assist him in putting on productions. They are not stipends. They're the same person. They have stipends that go to other people, not Mr. Mullen. So those are his major people that he gets support in the mission just yet. So his concern is by eliminating that. Those two in particular, if it continues to be those two, would mean he's essentially doing everything himself.
Unless there's another source of funding.
Unless there's another source of funding. Now,
especially the theater program, where they're able to raise $100,000.
And the theater program, yes.
We think they
do. That's exactly right. And that was the original intent, is that you would, theater, unlike music, doesn't have. Now it does not have a huge focus. They did do some obviously very sustained fundraising for Fringe, so that capability is there as well. That would be the first choice that we would be able to do to fundraise on the feedback on that.
And they can do that?
Oh, if I don't doubt that if they were called upon, that they could use this organization in existence for the speech and debate, I think we can still maintain a high quality with the programs. I'm not sure it's as realistic to think that we're going to get a booster organization for that, but part of what that reflects is that historically over, those numbers have been in existence for a long, long time, and that was really the numbers for participating in the speech and debate program has gone down fairly significantly over the last 10 years or so.
wonderful.
And the numbers in theater, is that?
Those are not going down.
So Jeff, if each of those positions are a person, it looks like, then what is the jazz band? How many people does that represent?
Well, the jazz band, the 5,000, what I did is I just said, here's a number, we'll figure it out. I talked to Tom Azad, he's very confident. It's a number that there is a very active youth organization. He's very confident that they can get $5,000. And that's why I originally said, let's do jazz band. There is a very active organization, over 100 kids involved in the program. What this would actually, and I've talked to him as well, and I think his preference is going to be to say, why don't we just say, take $5,000 and like $5,000 out of the curriculum transportation account, which is in there. Preference would be to say, okay, we have to take it, and that's why let's take it out of the transportation account as opposed to taking it out of, he just thinks that would be better.
So this doesn't represent people that are
if
doing
it? If we did it that way, then that would not represent people. But again, even if we were to keep it as people on books, mm-hmm. they could raise that amount of money. It's just the preference would be to represent it. Just about zero out what's in the budget for the next year.
And if the money for some reason couldn't be raised, then parents would pay for it? Is that
yes,
what
yes.
Saying?
Yes, yes. And he's very comfortable that 5,000 could be easily raised. But it would be raised mm-hmm. willingly, happily, over and keep the quality. I think the same thing is true with theater. Just as not an article that currently exists in the program to do that. I don't think that the same thing is true of speech and debate, but I do think that the program will continue at a high quality there just because the numbers are not as substantial. They're still there, and that goal is that we can come up later as opposed to being a trip. Kids are already disadvantaged in speech and debate. So kids are still doing well.
I have a question for Nancy and for Tom. In terms of co-curricular, are there any things that we can be looking at along the same vein of what the high school is doing? I know there's a theater thing that we're
exactly
now.
One.
Is it the theater?
Yes.
And we have put that into the budget in previous years, correct?
$2,070.
And originally, when the conception of that idea was done by volunteers, wasn't it?
No, I don't think so.
I think it was. I remember the. Does anybody?
It was all volunteer the first one or
yeah,
two years.
Because I remember Tina Harnden, I think.
And then it became a team.
Well, I was telling you about the proposal. At least one co-curricular activity that would be funded in the community. In my mind, there's quite a difference between the volunteer program and that's what I've done.
Okay. And I'm just questioning, is there room in either of the other two schools?
In the middle school, the thing is, we don't have a lot of assistant directors or anything, so if we cut one, which is always something that the board can do, it would be eliminating that opportunity. Because we don't have, our theater program has more people, but what we've done is we've just taken a certain number of hours and we divide it up differently to do different jobs, kind of thing, so the lump sum of hours is there. But the other ones, none of the others really have a co-director, so And if they have a co-director, it would be a...
So it's always just one person to take care of the program.
Like, for instance, right now, our student council is one person. Some years, that's been two people, but they've taken the same, whatever the hours are, and just split the hours. So it would be a little bit different situation for us. I would have to say, okay, then we wouldn't have that opportunity. And that's the difference.
Nancy, in that department, there's like $11,000 of travel and supplies and co-curricular. Can you give me some details as far as to, you know, is that mostly in the theater? Is that travel?
Is that where our travel for athletics is as well?
No.
Well, let me look at that, and I can tell you what it is. I know some of it is band travel. They don't go very far, but they have gone to Augusta the last several years. The music festival, they go to, I believe, is going to be at Scarborough next year. So there's some things to go to. Actually, I only have about $3,000 in there for travel.
And the travel, and the supplies of $8,000, $8,500?
Yeah. The travel's only about $3,000, so that's speech and debate, math team, and some music travel. We're pretty limited in and around. I think the furthest one that goes any places are math team, because sometimes the meets are in Oxford Hills. And everyone else is pretty close. Supplies, a large chunk of that supply money does come from the drama request. That's the biggest one that we have. And it's, let's see. And the civil rights team does some traveling as well. Okay. Things like supplies for speech and debate are only like 200. And, okay, the drama is the big one at 5,000. That's the biggest one from that. And then the others are things like, you know, a couple hundred dollars or whatever. We pay for our, the other big one would be our choral things that we do, and that comes in at $3,000. We have to pay for royalty rights. And that's the big part of the drama one.
As much as you felt, I sense that you felt strongly, and I support the Inspiration software, you didn't feel that there was any place to go in co-curricular to help with an academic thing like Inspiration software?
I honestly don't, because we don't have that many co-curricular things in the middle school. We have a lot of kids who, if they don't have a co-curricular activity to go to, hang out. Where do you hang out in Cape Elizabeth? Middle school age students don't always make the best decisions possible when they're in groups of more than one and not supervised. So it's a way to really offer some good constructive activities for them. Some of our activities really appeal to students who are not drawn to the athletic program. And that's also part of developing that whole child kind of idea as well, too. The Inspiration software one was a hard one for me to give up, because I think it would help just middle level learners and organization kinds of things. But it is something that we don't have now, so I'm not taking away a known opportunity where for some kids, Art Friday is the only thing to do. You know, the math club is what they do, and they're so excited about what they do with that, so those are hard things.
I know it's different than high school co-curricular. I know we're going to end up in a discussion later on regarding fees for athletics, possibly. But I would just like to put on the table that if we don't want to eliminate something such as co-curriculars, for example, at middle school level, that we sometimes think about where we want to go with co-curricular fees for art club, or not eliminate the program, but offer, whether it be through the school system or through community services, expansion, that opportunity to run the drama at Pond Cove also, and still offer it, but I'm happy.
The mechanism is there, that for every school eventually. That's certainly an option.
And sometimes it seems like it would make more sense to go to community services. I speak very freely, not knowing the implications for SUS programs, but
That's essentially our co-curriculum. It's through community services, and it's very busy and successful.
Yeah.
And parents pay.
Yeah.
I don't know, is that more burden on you too?
Depends whether we have the staff readily available, but whether you pay them through payroll or we pay them through fees, you know, I think that if we could attract the same people, our issue is always, can I attract that person to come teach for us? Certainly if a fee was associated with it, they could register through us, we would pay the people instead of you paying the people. Would that deter enrollment? It might some, but it's an option.
You would be paying the revenues.
We would be collecting revenues and putting it out to pay their staff persons.
Exactly, but you'd have the revenue, we wouldn't.
Correct.
But we wouldn't have the expenses.
That's the expenditure to come with it.
Some of the things that the middle school offers.
If we maintain it the way it is, we do it without revenue.
Right.
Okay, if it's a community service function, it's done with revenue. So it's, you know, it's a shift in how we're looking at it.
And I suspect that the families that really wanted their kids involved would be happy to pay for that particular program.
It works for the elementary level. I mean, how many programs do you run? It doesn't.
Probably 60 elementary programs each semester and with a success rate of about 95%. And in lots of cases, second, third sessions added because there's waiting lists. Not so much at the middle school. Middle school kids tend to want to do the school-sponsored activity versus a community services activity because there are options for them. The elementary school doesn't really have any other options unless they go through us. So it's difficult for us to program for the middle school population because, as Nancy said, they may have a little niche that they like, but basically they don't want to be organized after school unless it's an athletic event and once in a while one of your book reports.
Yep.
Other than that, they prefer not to, they prefer to hang out.
So we're trying to offer enough of those little things. And there's some things in our co-curricular that probably wouldn't work as, well, we'd have to check out and see how they would work. I don't know that they wouldn't. But things like the math teams, the math leagues, because they're school sponsored, they get to participate in meets and league events, which may or may not be open to them if they were just a community activity. Now, another one like the computer club could switch and not change in its nature at all because it's not a, there's no competition, there's no meets, there's nothing like that. They just do that for that. Art Friday could switch without a problem. So we have some that might be able to switch to that category without that issue, and others that we might be changing their opportunity significantly.
Would you be willing to look at it that way?
We will be willing to look at whatever you ask us to look at.
Thank you, Counselor.
I'm learning.
Send us a bill for this.
So is that a question about field trips?
Is that something we're going to hear
so
from
you? So let's leave that out there and keep that to the end, co-curricular.
I just needed a clarification on field trips in general. And I know that this has come up before, but I just need to understand why we can ask or how we can ask parents to pay for field trips, which are really part of the curriculum. If, I mean, the whole argument against asking, you know, for the laptop is that it's part of the, that's part of the curriculum. It goes against the public education policy. So, I mean, I just need to understand how we can do that because the field trips are, how can we ask parents to pay for field trips? Which are completely aligned with the curriculum, or part of the curriculum, when we can't ask parents to pay for such a larger ticket item like a laptop. Certainly, I mean, admittedly, a lot more expensive, but it's the same philosophy.
And I think in the past few years, we have been asking parents. This is a put back
but
into
how can
the
we do that? Right, but now all of a sudden the issue has been raised, so we can't ask
do we,
parents
do we do
to
some
pay
of it
for
because
something.
We don't hold anybody back. Our parents' associations and things help us with scholarships for students. Mm-hmm. So no one is denied. And also if somebody really didn't want to go on a field trip, we would provide an alternate activity.
It's kind of been a little fuzzy. Every year we bring it up, but it also seems that we've done it now for a couple of years. And some people, I get the feeling that the teachers philosophically agree with what Ann has just said.
That's right.
Yeah.
But the parents have pretty much acclimated themselves to the idea that we're sending $5 in for this trip.
But we did say, I mean, not to belabor the point, we did say that were we to institute fees for the laptops, we would have some sort of a fund for, you know, people who would not be able to purchase that laptop. I mean, it just seemed that we need to be consistent with this kind of thing.
Field trips.
It does show you that people do get used to.
And the point of something like Chewonky, which is a lot more than a $5 field trip. I have a $75 bill on my counter for Chewonky, which I will pay. But that's another thing that's part of the curriculum that everybody does. And it's a lot of money for something.
Right. And I know that we have a scholarship fund for that as well, for Chewonky, but it's just a point
to point out. The reality is we're not consistent. To be consistent, we've got to find a lot of money.
I'm not saying that we should, I'm just pointing out that.
Yeah, I know.
I mean, that we can then look at sometimes asking for fees for certain things that we didn't used to, but now we do because we didn't used to.
I think we might be reaching a threshold of dollars through the field trips of probably $7. So we sort of let it slide and get up to a graphing calculator, which is what, 350 a day, laptop, and it just,
right.
So we're reaching a point. But the field trip seems to be the idea that people, not cheerfully, but people pay.
Field trips. What exactly is this $1,500 per school represent?
For us, it's the eighth grade trip to a vessel.
So that's a complete trip that's gone.
The last 2 years, the Middle School Parents Association has funded it.
So it's, okay. Tom?
It would be spread out all the trips. I think that the fourth grade is more of the expensive.
But this is really, is this transportation
yes.
money?
Yeah. Yes, pure transportation.
There's no personnel money?
No. For the high school, it's probably, again, a lot of the field trip money. Sending kids to Ball State to orchestra festivals,
that's considered a field trip.
That's where it's been paid for historically for a long time. Yep. So that means kids are just that way, that came for us as well. Which is not a
thing. Now I have another question. Nobody should impute any philosophy about this. But our high school trips to Europe that come to the board because we are allowing one or more days off of school, the teacher is being paid.
We're allowing one or more days off of school for the teacher. The teacher is being paid.
Okay. Are we also incurring an expense for a substitute teacher?
Yes.
Same thing when we allow a trip to a social studies trip to New York. Teachers being paid, and we're also incurring the cost of a substitute teacher in order to enable a trip.
Yeah.
So, Kevin.
What are you saying?
Yeah.
It's pretty cool. What I'm saying is, perhaps within the cost of a field trip should include the cost of the substitute teacher. So, for example, if it's going to cost $100 for a substitute teacher, that $100, I'm thinking, should be folded into the student's
fee to go
on the, is that, talking about the actual teacher themselves, but I'm talking about these rather more extended trips, not the local trip to Augusta type of things, but.
And that's a practice we could get into, but I don't think it'll save any money out of this. You'd have to cut that amount of money. Substitute, that's our best guess anyway. Substitute account is just our best guess anyway. I don't know, until you went through it for a year and figured out what they say.
Well, we know, you know, it's nickel and dime at this point, okay? But we do know that we historically allow X number of these trips to happen every year. And those historically allowed trips generate X number of dollars in substitute trips.
It's nice. It's insignificant. They usually don't, like for the year trips, they may miss one, sometimes not any days.
Yeah, but when the town council is holding us to an 8.1% increase, nothing is inconsequential. If that's the way I'm looking at it. I'm not sure we should just be limiting ourselves to looking at big ticket items.
So what you're saying, so there would be, it would not affect what we're looking at right now. It would just be a different way of looking at field trips for the future.
Well, and I know we're coming up, the administrative team has come up with the cuts. The question I have is, you obviously don't agree with the cuts, because you're coming up with more cuts. So what are the issues on this that you don't agree with, so that we know how much we're talking about? Because we came up with the $266,000.
I'm shifting the town. I'm not suggesting any changes at all. Well, I will be strongly suggesting two changes. I'm just throwing out ideas. Sure. Let's start with the bus. And several people in the room already know how I feel about the bus. And the bus is a bogus cut. Okay, and it's too easy. There are funds coming back to us 2 years down the road. I would ask the question, have we ever purchased a bus where we haven't had funds come into us 2 years down the road? Okay, and how long is that?
The level is different.
The level has been different, but we have received some funding.
But there is always some sort of, as little as how much have we received against a given bus?
About 14,000.
Okay, and how much at the top side? Almost the entire cost of the bus?
Almost.
So do we know what we're losing in terms of subsidy by not buying this bus?
Years down the road, my guess would be we would lose about 25,000.
Which is almost the entire cost of the bus.
Is that what we got this year?
It depends on the funding formula at the time, and 2 years from now. We don't know what that would look like.
But based on all things being equal.
It depends on how many requests there are on the bus.
Correct. We've been lucky every year they've approved the number of buses this year.
That's number one. Reasons. There is some subsidy coming at us down the road. Number two is, if we do not buy a bus this year, we're creating a problem for next year's school board, or the school board the year after, or the school board the year after, because one of these days, as we know, to our chagrin, there is a catch-up time. And rather than dealing with the issue of one bus, we may be dealing with an issue of two buses. Cutting the bus is easy this year, and it becomes easy again next year. Perhaps we're talking about three buses. Sue, just off the top of your head, I mean, how many buses do we have on the edge of retirement?
Probably three. But we also have three extra buses for trips. In the afternoon, if one bus goes down, then we may not be able to do an athletic trip or a co-curricular trip or something like that. And for instance, we have five trips Wednesday, five athletic contests away Wednesday.
yeah, accommodating all of them, with some drop-offs, pickups, combining, moving together and stuff.
We're currently accommodating that, we have nothing at a service, but we do have three buses on the cusp.
We usually run out of drivers before we run out of buses at this point.
But there is the potential, and that potential gets greater every year, because as you reach a point of no return on repairs, repair money going into buses. So it's good money after bad, or bad money after good. There's that, okay. And the other thing is, who says we have to buy a bus in one given year and pay for it in cash?
Versus
leasing it for 3 years, or 4 years, or 5 years. I don't know if we can legally do it through cash flow. We have accounts that may be underspent, and if we appropriate those underspent funds for a bus and then reimburse ourselves from the following year's budget, we could do that corporately, but whether or not we can do that in a school scenario, I don't know. Somebody would have to look into that. But if we bought a bus on, let's say, a three-year lease, right, our outlay this year is X amount of dollars. Let's say it's 10%, $6,200. Okay, 2 years from now, we get $55,000, if that's the number.
We would only get what we leased for that 1 year. And they're only three-year leases. You can purchase a bus for a three-year lease.
So
let's say $20,000 the first year.
I'm talking about a lease purchase.
Lease purchase, $20,000 the first year. Let's say $20,000 every year for 3 years.
Mm-hmm.
We purchase our bus. The first year, we would pay $20,000 for the first year lease. 2 years down the road, we would get a portion of that through subsidy, not the total
$18,000. Well, the point remains the same, that spending $20,000 instead of $62,000 out of next year's budget.
Isn't that the way that we lease some of Gary's things?
It's just we've never thought of it that way before. I mean, because we trot in here as new school board members thinking we can apply business principles in school, and rapidly discover that the model doesn't really work very well. And then we go to the other extreme and forget business principles, and when the real answer is somewhere in the middle. And I'm suggesting, again, it's just a shift in paradigm.
Was there a reason why you do leases with the technology, because the life is so short on technology versus the life of a bus is 20 years? I mean, is
what on the bus is 10 years?
Theoretically, but you still own the bus at the end of the 3 years. Because I'm talking about a lease purchase, not a turn it in at the end of 3 years.
Oh, okay. So it'd still be just 3 year lease. And you don't know whether any other school system do it that way?
Some school districts do it through bond issues, I believe.
Would there be a reason that we wouldn't consider that?
Only if we don't get subsidy. It doesn't make sense. We're not going to receive subsidy for the lease. The state has been talking about doing that, so I would have to check with the state to make sure that they still reimburse for leases. I believe they do at this time.
That goes back to why I don't think we should not get a bus, whether or not we do it through lease, and reduce 40,000 instead of 62,000 or something like that. Or if we can pull off some other accounting trick, for lack of a better term, in order to do this, that is of course legal and would withstand any kind of audit. Differently looking at how we do business. But I think we're being penny wise and pound foolish to just cut a bus. It's too easy. And it's going to create pain for somebody else down the road.
So
the way that we're leasing or purchasing our buses.
Sure.
We want to go in that direction.
An alternative that might serve the purpose that we're looking to maintain the bus, but yet decrease our cost and spread it out a little bit.
And you agree as well?
I guess so. I mean, I don't know anything about that, but I don't know why you wouldn't look into it.
We'd have to think about what are we going to do next year. If we want to purchase another bus, which we would next year, we will have the $20,000 lease, plus we will either do a lease again or go back to the cash model.
Or really, are we able to, rather than a lease purchase situation, can we use the school district to borrow money?
That is, the lease is borrowing.
No, I understand that, but that's one kind of loan as opposed to, for example, a cash flow loan. We're not allowed to?
Correct.
Okay.
Now, but if you got into a lease situation and the lease, we're talking, pay in 3 years, we still have to technology lease, so you have to, I think, stay with a lease or issue a lease, and then next year you lease another bus, and then the following year you lease another bus, and then you retire that lease, so your expenditure is 20 years.
All we have to do is put together a model, because in theory, if you're doing 3 year leases, you're going to get this thing up to an expense of $60,000 again anyhow.
But your increase each year is only $20,000.
But then, you know.
It will help you for a couple of years, and then you're back to the $60,000 per year, and then, right.
But you're getting more $20,000 increments.
Right.
Right.
But then you don't have options of cutting it out or cutting it back.
No, we're stuck with the lease.
And the only other thing is predicting what the reimbursement is every 2 years, because eventually the reimbursement catches up. I mean, let's say we move to the lease model. I haven't done a spreadsheet on it, all right? But at the end of, you know, in year three, we're up to an expense of $60,000 gross, but in theory, we're getting $20,000 in revenue. The following year, we'd be up to, we're still at $60,000 gross, but in theory, there's $40,000 in revenue.
Eventually, that can catch up.
Exactly. At some point down the line, all things being equal, then the revenue will also catch up to the lease if we continue using the lease model. So you, hopefully, and again, it's dependent upon the state, you reach a point where it is essentially a wash.
If the state is wash.
Exactly. But it puts us in no worse situation than we're in right now.
Right, because the state could not fund the 60 either. We could get 14 back on the 60. Which is happening with that, right?
Well, and the money that we're getting this year is for a bus that we purchased when?
You're talking about the money for 04, 05? Is the bus we purchased last year?
No, 03, 04.
The money we got this year.
This year.
03, 04 is for the bus we purchased.
So it takes 2 years.
But let me ask you a question. How much are we actually getting this year?
For the bus?
For the bus that we purchased 2 years ago.
We'd have to look at the printout, but I'm thinking it's about $50,000.
Well, how are we, what are we actually, what's our treatment of that $50,000?
It's part of our subsidy state total. When you see on the spreadsheet the amount of state subsidy existed as part of that.
State subsidy is a little complicated, but can we also look, can you apply that revenue to this year's expense? I mean, we've already incurred the expense. Have we accrued the expense on our books?
When we spent it.
We expensed it. We didn't accrue and expense it. Okay. So there's nothing on the books, but it's $50,000 to be applied to.
Correct.
So that's, you know, there's enough. Have we looked at in the past, that $50,000 becomes dedicated to a brand new bus. So that particular revenue offsets the expense to $250,000, or, you know, in that effect, it's $12,000. Does that work?
I mean, not really, because your
state subsidy is a certain dollar amount, $1.5 million. If you take out the bus of $50,000 from that, you'll have listed $1.45 million for state subsidy, $50,000 for the bus. The total is the same.
That's all moving state subsidy.
I'm getting into a technical area that you and I would understand the conversation. I'm not sure how many other people would. But, you know, I'm starting to think in terms of matching revenues with expenses on the gap, and I don't know if that works yet. So I'll leave that alone, but that I've said enough. So I think, you know, I think it's worth taking another look at how we do things.
Okay, so are we saying that the board is considering putting the bus back into the budget and having Pauline check on the options for 3 years?
And if that's the case, we could move the money to find another 4,000.
Right. So, but that's what we are saying for right now, correct?
But I would like to hear just, I mean, I'm assuming that it's a big chunk of money. And so I'm assuming that it was put in there because
a cut of 20,000.
So I'm assuming that it was put in there because there was nothing else that could be found to fill that amount. Is that right? That was
the recommendation. Well, that's the recommendation. I think
this
is the discretion.
As Kevin said, it was a big number, and helped us get to where we needed to get.
But I mean, I don't want to direct, you know, the administrators to
What you're saying about the bus makes sense, and I personally like the idea if it's possible to do. And we're at a different time right now. Now we're talking about from this list, and we might have some changes in it, $20,000 from somewhere else rather than $60,000 from somewhere else would be very, very difficult. $20,000 is different. So I like that idea. We can do it. I think it's a great idea.
As long as it's legal. I mean, I have a whole pile of other ideas, but I'm not sure that they're legal. They're legal in corporate America, okay? In corporate America, they would not incur the wrath of the IRS.
Yeah, I was going to say, you signed that one.
All right, but I don't know whether or not you can do it in a public corporation, which is essentially what we are.
Okay, so can we move on from the bus then? So Pauline will investigate the 3-year lease for the bus. And so we keep in the back of our minds that we are looking for an additional $20,000 to what's on the sheet if the bus comes off.
The only other thing I would add, Pauline, is I wouldn't necessarily limit myself to a 3-year scenario.
I'll check with the state to see if they're allowed.
Okay, another question.
You know, as I think about the $20,000, if that was where we needed to go, we've talked a little bit about smaller things. The CIP, I was kind of surprised that there was only $2,000 cut out of the CIP. Just like to hear what it was and how strongly you felt about what's
CIP
remaining.
Took, $30,000
in the original.
$30,000 already cut.
Which was $20,000 with ductwork.
Right.
What's the total
plan? For CIP? Locker room renovation.
The total what? For maintenance,
it was $136,000.
And the duct cleaning was at which school?
In the locker room upgrade.
That was the
Boy,
first
that locker room's never going to get done, huh?
It isn't. You won't even want to go near the door. Never mind, go in.
I mean, I think for, how many years did we start the facilities committee? 4 years ago. We've been talking about those locker rooms now, 4 or 5 years.
Pauline, what's the total CIP over the prior year?
It's just for maintenance. Just for maintenance, it was down $8,000, about 8,800.
We've had the discussion that, we're going to renovate and it's quite a cost. And the capital improvement continues to go down every year. You don't keep the buildings up. So we can level fund the CIP for quite a few years. I cut another $10,000 out of it, things don't get done, and then 5 years from now you'd be asking kind of for another $6 million to renovate. Mm-hmm. So I think it's,
well, I think we were there before you were here, before I was here. I mean, we've all heard those stories. But you know, I guess I would say, you know, whatever we have in the CIP plan, say for middle school work, aside from the duct cleaning and the locker rooms, I think we need to take care of the middle school. I think we need, you know, some maintenance and so on at the high school.
But stuff was left out of the project to take care of the CIP.
And that's why I'm saying the high school, I'm not questioning that as much as maybe Pond Cove. I mean, are there things that we can take out of, you know, with the renovation and everything that we have, or the new building
Pond Cove is it's an addition, so the same stuff, it's no different than the middle school. What's the difference in which?
I don't know, I'm just looking for something.
Yeah.
I don't know.
There might be some lines and shades that we have money, but they're both, I think, for both schools.
And that was the first to ask for expense. It was a first year expense. It hasn't never been replaced, but it's $5,000.
Never been replaced since when?
It hasn't been in the budget for a while, so it shows up as a new expense. So, it's the first time they've been since the renovation.
I think they've put it off.
We've had the request for 2 or 3 years to do something.
Are
the way towards the 20,000? Yeah, I don't know.
Yeah. I mean, are they in such terrible shape that, you know,
the ones that fall down and don't work? Yeah.
Well, I don't know.
Something like that. I mean, your call for me, certainly.
I mean, you're there in the classroom.
Very don't want what they.
No, I was going to say, we want to be cautious about that ductwork cleaning. We're going to get caught on that with air quality. So.
Well, I guess I would prefer for us to say, if we need to go there, let's cut 10,000 from CIP, but let Ernie and the building supervisors decide where it is. I don't need to prioritize it as blinds versus ductwork cleaning. You've already made a decision on ductwork cleaning, but I was just kind of curious. I was just surprised that the CIP didn't show up.
I think the only thing we had at CIP was furniture, right? And we're down to one room, and we've got to furnish one room. We don't currently have the classroom, so I don't know.
Well, so maybe the question should be asked of Ernie.
Right, he would make a decision.
Which
are more critical than others.
Yeah, right.
Based on the emergency of the time. It's up first.
So are we saying it's a possibility? Can I put it up here along with co-curricular and middle school?
We have to look at that big white elephant, you know, under athletics. And so it needs to be up there just because we don't know where we're going to go.
Is there anything else on this list? I mean, the only thing I'm a little concerned about is professional development out of each school. I'm concerned of that coming out, but, you know, because I just keep thinking with technology, whatever we do for next year, whether we have laptops, we know we're going to continue with the laptops in the 7th and 8th grade, I just really get concerned about professional development with teachers and making sure that we're doing enough. Did it come out of your area? Yeah, it came out of technology.
But that was, that particular fee right there was, nominal was always that week long academy that teachers were doing that. I've sent 4 or 5 teachers to the year for that, for the last several years, and they're not having that anymore. So, and that's why the budget is extended.
Will you do your own?
Things that we're doing are still going on.
Okay, so then let's move to athletics. Where do we want to start?
Is the proposal still to impose participation fee?
Now, the figure we came up with is $50,000. Our discussion at the district leadership team was that we'd ask the athletic administrator to take another look at any possible cuts in that budget. A portion of that cuts, and the rest of it will come out of the majority of the participation fee.
Then I have to tell you that I'm opposed to participation fee. And I am opposed to participation fee first and foremost because in the past when we've argued about and discussed the participation fee, one of the big reasons I heard for not doing a participation fee was the administrative headache involved in turning somebody into a collection agency and keeping track of this stuff. Now that we're actually talking about doing the fee, all of a sudden that administrative headache seems to have gone away. I think it's still there.
I don't think anyone said it's gone away.
That's number one. Number two is, I think, and Ann has already touched on this, we have a potential constitutional issue in terms of laptops. And nobody, including our attorneys, really wants to touch that with a 10-foot pole. And I'm opposed to opening that door in athletics and giving someone an opportunity to challenge it on a constitutional basis. Third, the other districts that at one point or another had participation fee have done away with the participation fee. And I don't know what they've done in its stead. But we know, for example, the local one was Scarborough. That participation fee scenario no longer exists over in Scarborough.
Oh, I think they still have one.
I thought that was done away with.
It's not much, but they still have one.
Well,
I talked to the athletic administrator.
Shocked at how low it
is.
And they have all kinds of problems.
Well,
they do have one.
There you go. I mean, you know.
When you say they have all kinds of problems with it, what does that mean?
The coaches responsible for collecting the fees. And all this. It adds to their paperwork. You know, they come down to and ready to play games, and some kids haven't paid their fees, so they can't play, amongst other things. But also, it's only $12, too. I mean, it's kind of a wash on the time and energy, because the league is allowed to get out.
But, yes, and like, community services collects fees. Yeah. Kids do participants pay. You keep track of them.
Yeah.
So it is possible. Good organization. People in charge of doing certain things can happen. So you pay all, you have hundreds and hundreds of kids paying for it. They pay for Little League, they pay for new soccer, they pay for Casco Bay, all those things. And they do it, and they don't let the kids play if they don't pay. So, I mean, I think it's possible.
I didn't say it wasn't, did not say it wasn't possible.
Don't. You don't get in the game, you don't get a uniform.
I'll believe it when I see it.
That's the only way you can do it, otherwise, you run it.
Exactly. I still, my single biggest issue is, of course, the constitutional issue. The next issue is that with participation fee, we do have people in this town who is not as well-to-do as other people in this town, and I suspect, based on what I've seen, that those people will opt out of participation rather than opt into a scholarship program. All right. When all is said and done, whether it's a $50,000 participation fee, which I believe if we do decide to do that, it's going to be $50,000 plus administrative expenses. Or whether we cut the total budget $50,000, the athletic budget $50,000. It's all, that $50,000 is coming from the same place, the parents' pockets. And I think it is simpler and cleaner to do it in terms of a cut. And further, I'll tell you how to do the cut. For example, ice hockey. You know, ice hockey is near and dear to my heart personally. That is a, right now when the current budget is almost $24,000, which is roughly 9% of the athletic budget. Well, 9% of the $50,000 cut will be assessed to ice hockey, and so on down the line with each and every sport. Whatever their percentage is of the total current budget, that is the amount of the cut that they'll be assessed. And that's really all I have to say on the topic. I just think we're opening a can of worms that we're not prepared to deal with if we resort to the participation fee as opposed to a cut.
Keith, if it were a cut, just a cut, not participation, how would you handle that?
If we cut all the freshman programs, that would be $10,000. If we cut programs in order that we added them, we could cut the $2,300 that we have designated football. We could cut Nordic skiing, which is $10,000. We could cut girls and boys lacrosse, it would be $20,000. Those are the order that we've added those programs.
But can we go back and look at it rather than do that? Look at individual sports, I think it'd be hard for us to come up with that kind of money. But whether it's 9%, which I don't know if that's the best way to do it, but we can go back and look at some of the things that we're doing. For instance, we pay time for indoor tennis.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. We could eliminate that.
Yep.
Out of things like that, we could eliminate. A lot of districts don't pay that, for example. And I don't know, a fair way is to do the 9% across the board. Maybe it is, maybe it isn't.
Some would be 9, some would be a lot.
Right, yeah. Because some sports services are less expensive to operate.
Yeah.
The issue, what I am saying to you does not require doing away with any program.
Yeah.
Being very specific about that. We know, I'm basing my proposal on the premise that if you impose a participation fee, the funds will be raised. And if you take a cut, the funds will be raised. And the funds will be raised a lot cleaner in addressing a cut. And the cut, regardless, even if the money wasn't raised, does not necessarily require losing one single team.
I think, too, that there isn't a sport that should necessarily be cut.
I agree. You know, I don't think it
should. Yeah, and I sat on the board several years ago when we added football. And at that time, I remember Keith Witherall sitting here saying, well, you know, we're setting ourselves up for, at some point in time, we have too many sports. We have to keep supporting all of these when we were adding football to the mix. and that we're setting ourselves up for future boards that are going to have to make tough decisions in athletics, and we're here. So, yeah, I don't think it's, you know, last in, first out. But I think, you know, as Tom said, in terms of what tennis time or, you know, if there are things that that we can throw back on the users.
Well, I think Kevin's idea is a good, I mean, I could go back and look. I mean, for example, the percentage that might have to be cut in tennis could be covered by what we pay for indoor court time. I mean, ice hockey would be a case that probably be around $4,500. I talked to the booster president today, I know they'd be more than willing to come up with that money.
Yeah, and
And it would be divided up amongst the sports.
I'm trying to find a way that's fair, that does not take anything away from anybody, but also does not open the door to some sort of mess down the road when somebody, and we know there's somebody out there who will raise the constitutional question. All right?
I don't know, because there are several schools that have participation fees that hasn't been raised yet, so.
Well, it hasn't up to this point, but we're in a whole different place than where we were just a couple of years ago. I mean, here we are, as Tom said earlier, I mean, we're talking about 8.1%, or what was it, 5.4, which is still much higher than last year's budget increase, but one heck of a lot tougher to deal with. So, you know, what I hope to do is preserve what we have and do the same thing, unfortunately, that the governments, the federal and state governments are doing to us. Everybody's cost shifting. The feds come up with a mandated program, they don't pay for it, so the state has to pay for it. The state passes along the cost to us, we're passing along the cost to the taxpayer. There's got to be an end, and that's why there's a Pulaski revolt going on.
Well, you know, and I look at everything that we're talking about tonight. The central theme is having the users or the parents paying for their children. You know, whether it's co-curricular, whether it's athletic, whether it's field trips. I mean, look at the laptop discussion. So you know, we're getting there, and maybe this is a step before we get to participation fees. Nobody's going to say that that's going to go away. You know, that that's not going to be a reality next year or the following year. But can we get to a $50,000 reduction without them? I guess that's the question.
I think we could use Kevin's model, and I'd have to go through and figure out the percentages, but I feel pretty confident that the individual activities would be willing to pay that amount.
And so then it would just be the boosters that would make up the difference? Is that how, what you're...
Well, in some cases, it could be
depending on the issue.
I would meet with the coaches.
Depending on what the...
Mm-hmm. To see if there were, you know, maybe it's supposed to get new uniforms in soccer next year, and maybe we don't get those.
And so you would just figure out where the needs would lie, and then...
But it also could be a situation where, you know, I don't know how high the bash amount of hold to the percentage. And I think Keith needs to look at that and discuss what the process to the next step is. But he may go through and say, for instance, the soccer uniforms may be for that soccer team 15% of their budget. So that means some other support that doesn't have that flexibility or risk just isn't anything there. Maybe 5% cut or something like that. I mean, I think we need to be flexible on it. I also think that when we meet there tonight, I hope there's some flexibility in us getting together as a district leadership team and giving you some more feedback and your suggestions. Because I have some things I'd like to share too, things that we've looked at, and the whole bus scenario has really, we do at least, it's changed that, because I would anticipate maybe a $60,000 cut in here. That may not happen. Does help significantly. So we need to have that more discussion.
No, and let me be clear about where I'm coming from on this. All right? 2 months ago or so, we didn't know we were going to be faced with this kind of issue. And during the course of our budget conversations, some issues were raised that I personally, at the time, didn't think that was the place to have that conversation. But tonight, we're in a different place. Tonight, we're looking at a real number of $266,000 that we have to arrive at. And I'm not writing anybody in this room a prescription. All right? I'm just throwing out ideas. I still have no intention of trying to micromanage the team, but I do want to throw out ideas now that may sound like micromanaging, but if I don't throw these ideas out, I'm being negligent in fulfilling my responsibilities. And I've had outside conversations with other people. Another bug of mine is postage. And the reason I have a bug about postage is not in sending out the things that we need to send out, but I keep saying to myself, why are we paying the postage to mail college applications out on behalf of the students? In a community with this kind of wealth, why are we, the school department, incurring that expense? And the reason we're incurring that expense, as was related to me, was that they're afraid that the kids will forget to mail their applications. I'm sorry, that just doesn't cut the mustard for me. Now, yeah, it may be a nickel and dime figure in the scheme of things, but I'd rather take all those nickels and dimes on the postage and apply them back to professional development. I'd like to go through our supply account and say, can we cut 5% and put it back into professional development? I mean, we spent a lot of time and effort getting, there are certain things that are, you know, that I'm willing to agree are untouchable. Class size, teacher load, all right? Programs for marginal and special ed students. That one's my particular one. But for the rest of this stuff, I mean, we've got to find a way to make things happen. And it's just time, I think, that we have to take a different approach, because we don't know what's going to happen next year. Are we facing this again next year? And if we are, deferring the pain for a year is not going to be helpful, because it will only be more painful next year. I'm just throwing it out to everybody, my colleagues, Tom, you, the district leadership team. Let's try to think a little differently. I'm not going to resort to that let's think outside of the box nonsense. But there are things that I think that we just have ignored in the past because we didn't want a nickel and dime, and we didn't want to give the perception we were micromanaging. And perhaps being so concerned over the micromanaging, I, for one, have been guilty of not saying what's on my mind. So this is the time to do it. I'm sorry.
I just have a question about athletics. If you didn't go B and you made some cuts, but you wanted to try something, have you ever seen anything along the lines of a uniform fee for participants that would help manage it so that, imagine there are times when it's hard to estimate how many uniforms you might need because of increasing enrollments at the high school and how many kids would be coming into a program, but if you had that capability of buying a uniform for your child, I almost would rather, as a parent out there, pay for it, hoping my child would do 4 years of it, and I'd be responsible for that.
If they don't grow.
There's going to be an opportunity to reorder.
And you're saying that they'd use the same uniform every year, regardless of which team they're on?
No.
Not really.
No.
Those swim trunks would not look good in all the sports.
Because the swimmers buy all
the Speedo on the soccer field.
I know what you're saying. Well, it'd be like a participation fee, but it'd be a uniform fee.
It'd be a uniform fee. And whether the kids keep it or whether it would help, is there any possibility there's an advantage to it, to the athletic department starts managing users.
Yeah, the advantage would be, the good problem, we get collecting uniforms every year, yeah. And many of them do end up paying for them.
And you're right, because in community services, I used to try to collect them. I said, they buy them, and they keep them. And they all pay for them, every year. They buy them, they keep them, and I don't have to collect them.
I would just be interested if you, if you're gonna look at that, that might be part of the proposal, I think.
Might be a different way, yeah.
You know, and also, along the lines of what we were talking about with co-curricular in Pine Cove in the middle school, I mean, are there things that would make sense to go to community services?
Boy, don't miss that, our popular.
I did that on purpose.
There are things that will go.
I mean, in terms of, I think I said the same thing about Nordic skiing, when you were asking for another Nordic ski coach. That, you know, we do all the downhill skiing through community services. I mean, I don't know, is that an example of something that? Oh, okay.
I think you might run into that same, I would wonder if you'd run into that same issue of league participation.
Okay, that, and I wasn't thinking that, so I don't know.
But I think maybe to look at, for instance, I don't know, but if soccer's up the uniforms issue, maybe we do that as a pilot and see what the cost would be for the uniforms if kids purchase them, what it can be, and kids always have an extra pair of soccer shorts, and they just buy them.
Generally, you'd be looking at about 110 a uniform.
So the kid pays for the uniform?
110.
Can I just kind of let it?
What kind of uniform?
Today.
Your kid?
Two shirts, shorts, socks.
Okay. I guess.
I know this.
$4,500 in here for soccer uniforms, for girls' boys' soccer.
So they pay for it, and they give it to you?
How much money was that?
$4,500.
There's also some cross-country uniforms in there.
Yep.
And the number of.
Oh, it is a different thing, yeah.
And then the number of socks we buy, I mean.
We do tend to wear socks out, yeah.
Well, you know, they don't turn those back in, right? They probably keep them.
They do in some cases, but some of them are pretty bad shape.
I don't want them, I'd rather buy them, you know, and keep them than I would use someone else's. But I guess my other point is that, I mean, for example, I just got a letter today, you know, from lacrosse saying that we were buying uniforms. The boosters group was buying uniforms for the girls lacrosse varsity club.
I don't know anything about that, because they have their uniforms, they've played two games.
I know, but I've been asked for a donation, you know, for it. And so if this inequity is out there, the boosters are doing this.
But see, the boosters should be checking to keep them.
Okay, but.
That's part of our policy.
The point is, we're having a hard time maintaining our policy, there's inequities out there. And if a uniform fee is a part, is a way to address some of that and create revenue for the department, I would just ask that we explore that possibility. I didn't mean to get lacrosse in trouble.
Well, I'll be checking with them tomorrow.
We have it on tape.
They are, and I'm sure the coaches, my daughter was here.
Where you going?
I know.
Is that everything from the school board on this list, all, everyone's questions?
Now, can I just want to, because we need to, the public hearing, I guess we can continue this conversation, because the public hearing on the budget is May 10th, isn't it? And the town council will vote on that, on the bottom line.
Total budget, yes.
So my question is, when do we need to make our final decision? Because we don't have a meeting scheduled between now and then, we need a special meeting, or what difference does it make?
My thought on this is, what do we need anything for? where's the time limit on making the decision?
Because we know what the bottom line is.
Exactly. I mean, we've been told what the bottom line is, and the only people who get to decide how to spend that bottom line is us.
Right.
Now, of course, we have, you know, as we make our decision and finalize whatever this $266,000 is, I mean, we have an obligation to the public to let them know what's
going
on. But I don't see that we have any
time constraints. But what I would suggest, we have a board meeting scheduled that next day, at 11. I don't know, in the past, you've had either before or after. The old style of doing the budget, we used to do some of the smaller budgets at one of the regular board meetings. Didn't you do that?
Yes. I've been here a long time. Yet the answer is yes.
Yeah. I mean, so we could, I mean, I would, the district leadership team is meeting.
Once upon a time.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, right.
I'm missing something.
So I'm saying.
I'm not understanding what you're saying. What are we, are you talking about people making a presentation to us?
Well, we need the district leadership team.
Has to get together.
Right. And come back to you with some of these suggestions and how we plan to deal with that. And I'm saying we can bring that to you on the 11th, because you already have a scheduled meeting.
Oh, yeah, I'm fine with that.
Either as an extension of the finance committee or something like that.
Or do we make the finance committee meeting longer and just hold it outside? Instead of in the conference room, hold it out?
Right.
So it can be taped?
Do it before.
Yeah.
And we'll come to you with recommendations on how to deal with some of these.
And then just in the course of the actual meeting, just deal with the.
Right.
Yeah, this is what we're doing.
If it is, then at the meeting, you can actually adopt a new budget.
Right.
On the 11th?
Right.
And then the town council approves it, don't you?
No, they approve it.
Well, they're already gonna approve the number. They approve the number.
They're approving. Well, we're giving them the number, this $266,000. But we can, a day later, say where it's coming from.
Yeah, I mean, they've given us the bottom line. That's all she wrote. Unless we wanna go back and peel the bottom line.
And, yeah.
Okay, so are all school board members okay with that?
Yeah.
Yes. So then that's what we will do.
No, I appreciate the encouragement. I think it's good feedback. Things we have done.
And that's it for tonight, right?
Well, there's one other issue that I just wanna share with you. Because of the timing of it, we had this issue last year, so I just wanna share it with you so that you can think about it and not, because of the timing of a trip. Chef wants to tell you about it. Do we have information?
They didn't decide to be hearing.
I thought you said you didn't want me to bring them, I'm sorry.
Oh, okay, sorry, I misunderstood. There are two national speech and debate tournaments. And we always get obviously notice at the end after all the debate tournaments are done about whether or not kids qualify for either or both of the tournaments. One of the tournaments, and we've had kids who've been invited to attend both of the tournaments this year, which is wonderful. And one of them is in Boston. It's in, I'm sorry, I didn't, it's in May before the end of the school year. Another one that is, that's the Catholic Princeton Tournament, two major national Princeton leagues. That's the Catholic Princeton Tournament. It is a national Princeton tournament, but one of our students has been invited to attend. That's much more, that's much farther away. It's in Salt Lake City, Utah. Actually, after school gets out, one of our students will be attending. The money is there.
We're not paying travel expenses?
We have all typically paid travel expenses as well.
I
Well, next year maybe, I understand that, next year may be a different issue.
No, but I'm saying this year, why deviate from the norm?
From what I'm saying, I mean, there are other expenses that we could pick up, I think, in terms of food, any personal workshops that they attend, because they have all kinds of things that we can be able to go to as well, sort of make sure that they're out of the box, getting there. One is very close, Boston, overnight. I think it's kind of true, it's might be a little obviously, for one.
Who goes with the students?
Right now, what we're looking at is for the Boston one, that would be a teacher during the school year. Investigating the possibility of that, I've seen if a parent would be willing to go, particularly if the girl who was invited to attend the national tournament, to see if she graduated at that point. I don't think there's a reason that I can make up why we couldn't send a parent. And we have to investigate if she.
The child?
Yes. We have to investigate the tournament rules to see if they require. Require staff early. Sometimes they do because sometimes they have to provide judges. So if we have to do that, then we can just make a call. So it is very consistent with other requests that we put forward. It's always late.
Because you don't know.
Because we don't know. We just don't know if anybody can qualify.
So what do you look for the school board for?
Now, I don't know what the one that's after school's over, you know, we stand on that, but the other one is school time.
But we would need.
I think we.
The hope to spend time.
If school related, we had this discussion once, if school related, then we either approve it.
You're approving, but what you're approving on these trips is the time away from school.
I understand.
So what happens when there's no time away from school?
But if it's happening under the name of Cape Elizabeth.
You know, are we approving of the time away from school? Because if it's, right, depending if they use our name or not.
I mean, she would, in both cases, they would be recommended to go to high school that way. And there's at least a possibility that you would have to have a staff member who would solve it.
So in that case, you'd have to. No, but you can't vote, but we wanted to give you the information prior to the next meeting.
So we'll come to the next meeting with all the information and then we will take a vote on it.
But last year, we brought it all at the meeting at the same time because it's always a short time.
Yeah.
But we do a lot of stuff.
Are you looking for the?
May 28th.
May 28th.
So we still have time at our next meeting then?
Right.
We've heard about it now and we'll vote on it.
Right, and that's why I just wanted to put it on, and obviously there's some plans that have to be made and all that sort of thing.
I think so, yeah. That's it. Thank you.
Sarah, you ready for the question?